Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Whiskey Business, How Small Batch Distillers Are Transforming American Spirits, by Tom Acitelli, narrated by Barry Abrams. Aperitif. And then there were craft spirits. 2013, Boston. It was an ungodly hour to be drinking rum. I wanted, however, to see Buffalo Bill Owens, who opened one of America's first brew pubs, and this was my chance. We had spoken by phone and emailed several times for my History of American Craft Beer, yet had never actually met. He had moved on from craft beer to another interest and would be in Boston that weekend in June 2013 to tour a new distillery that his trade group, the American Distilling Institute, helped promote. He knew I lived in nearby Cambridge. Would I like to meet? The craft beer history had been published, but yes, meeting Bill would be a treat, even if it meant an early Saturday wake-up as well as a subway ride and a long walk to a more remote area of South Boston. Two first cousins had started Grand Ten Distilling in 2011 in an old iron foundry, one of several long, docile warehouse spaces in Southie, an area that had transitioned from industry and organized crime to biotechnology and food trucks. Matt Nurnberger had an MBA and therefore handled the business side, and his cousin Spencer McMinn was a chemistry PhD who handled the distilling. Matt and Spencer were both there when I arrived, as was Bill, dressed in a black vest over an orange short-sleeve shirt, square brown glasses perched on a perfectly triangular nose just above a thin white mustache that matched his salty, spiky hair. Bill held court throughout the entire tour, which included a rundown of Grand Ten's equipment, such as its gorgeous copper stills, and which ended with samples at the small bar toward the former foundry's front. I sipped Grand Ten's rum and was pleasantly blown away. Fresh and flavorful, clean in mouthfeel and appearance, it tasted like no other spirit I had consumed before. None of that acrid, overly alcoholic taste so common to bigger brands. Instead, the spirit's components were distinct and upfront, particularly the molasses, which provided the rum's sugar. Here was a spirit you could savor, not simply knock back to get drunk quickly. As novel as their products tasted, I also sampled a whiskey and a gin, Grand Ten's operation was thoroughly familiar, from the backstory to the vibe to the physicality. The place looked and felt like a craft brewery, relatively small and, by necessity, cramped, in an area of town that could certainly use the trade. The libations produced in small batches with more traditional methods anathema to bigger macro competitors, which, to be honest, probably did not see Grand Ten as much of a competitor in 2013. And the cousins Nurnberger and McMinn, casual in appearance and tone, but unapologetically earnest about what they were doing. Business-wise, too, the distillery was familiar. A startup in the drinks business, crafting its wares for sale locally and not much beyond. The emphasis was on craftsmanship and connectedness, not putting a bottle in everyone's dining or dorm room or liquor cabinet. It was much the same ethos that craft brewers had long emphasized, beginning back in the 1960s and really picking up steam in the 1980s, when entrants such as Owens himself decided to start making small batches of beer with traditional methods and ingredients and selling it locally and not much beyond. In Owens's case, in the same Northern California restaurants where the beer was made. I easily discovered that I was far from the first to make this spirits beer connection. The whole thing seemed like a rerun at first glance. Only the drink had changed. Connecting what was being called craft spirits with craft beer seemed de rigueur in media coverage of the emerging trend. And several craft distilleries seemed to understand that journalists and consumers expected that. The packaging of many craft spirits and the official backstories provided on websites and in marketing materials consciously aped and echoed the tradition-heavy, anti-macro ethos of craft beer. It worked beautifully to some degree. An industry survey in 2016 found that nearly 60% of store owners and 25% of bar and restaurant owners thought craft spirits would perform like craft beer sales-wise over time. Yet I soon discovered that there were more than a few craft distilleries behaving disingenuously when it came to such craft beer-like packaging and marketing. Simply put, there was no tradition, and they were quite macro in a lot of respects. They bought in bulk what the industry called neutral or rectified spirits, almost 100% pure ethyl alcohol that could then be cut and flavored, and simply rebottled it with craft-like labels complete with bucolic shots of countryside distilleries and talk of local origins. The only thing local was the bottling. Or they bought the finished product and did much the same thing, rebottled it with their own misleading labels. There were no government regulations prohibiting these operations from doing either. These faux craft distilleries, I soon realized, accounted for a not insignificant number of what the media often labeled craft. If they were not a majority, then they were certainly a sizable minority. Then there was the plain fact that many macro operations produced fine spirits in what for them were relatively small batches. This was particularly true of whiskeys, especially that American original, bourbon. A distillery did not have to be small in size and independently owned to craft a solid whiskey or even a solid vodka or gin. In fact, it could be advantageous to be large, given that many of the nation's biggest distilleries were also the oldest and therefore awash in the most institutional knowledge about how to make a particular spirit. Again, especially whiskey. These dual realities stood in stark contrast to the craft beer that the media and the industry often compared craft spirits with. There were phantom craft beers, to be sure, macro brewery products that certainly looked micro, but they rarely, if ever, tasted so. The bigger breweries often used shortcuts, including chemical additives and non-traditional ingredients such as rice, and favored the sort of voluminous output that can be bad for beer, a drink usually best when freshest and therefore closest to its source. Macro distilleries' smaller batch spirits, on the other hand, whatever their packaging, often did taste as good as, if not better than, their tinier counterparts' offerings. It was all a muddle. Try as the media and others might, they could not quite fit craft spirits into the same neat taste rubric as craft beer. Nor could one fit it into a timeline as clean as craft beers, or American fine wines for that matter. Both beverages can trace their post-World War II origins to a handful of events, and at most, to three or four individuals. And both craft beer and fine wine, Merlot, Chardonnay, Cabernet Sauvignon, etc., can trace their respective chronological ascents in America linearly from Northern California out into the subsequent decades and the rest of the United States. New arrivals in craft beer and fine wine were usually acutely aware of whose shoulders they were standing on, and that they were standing on them to begin with. Not so craft spirits. Pioneers and producers in this movement developed in different pockets of the country at different times, under sometimes profoundly different circumstances, and often worked in isolation, usually on a hunch or as a means for that much extra money, unaware of any kindred souls elsewhere in the nation. Accidents of history and America's vast geography were part of the reason for this. The irreconcilable differences in the kaleidoscope of spirits was another. Corn-based bourbon developed in what came to be called Kentucky, because that's where the corn and the settlers of Scotch-Irish descent ended up. The hub of starchy vodka production in America in the mid-20th century was in Connecticut, because of vodka's development in the Old World and then the New during the previous centuries. Sugary rum distillation oozed up from the southernmost regions of the country, because that's where slave-powered sugar cultivation took hold, and on and on. I soon found that trying to sketch the growth of American craft spirits as a multi-branch tree from a single clump of roots was impossible, and that those who did so were either disingenuous themselves or simply didn't see all the dots still left to connect. Finally, as many before me, I ran quickly into the ongoing debate over what exactly constituted a craft spirit. What were we even talking about here? This was much more contentious than the debate over what defined a craft brewer. The Brewers Association, a powerful trade group with origins in the 1970s, had long offered a definition that at least provided a framework for thinking about craft beer and craft brewing. As for fine wine, France had defined those parameters long ago, as had federal and state regulations about how much of a grape had to be in a certain wine for the winery to call its product by that grape. Oregon, for instance, required that any Oregon Pinot Noir contain 90% Pinot Noir juice from grapes cultivated in the Beaver State. The debate over a craft spirits definition, on the other hand, spawned multiple lawsuits and pointed recriminations in the media. Some held that the independence of the distillery owner or owners was sacrosanct, the key ingredient to any craft spirits definition. Others thought that traditional ingredients, equipment, and methods mattered more. Still others vehemently argued that operations that were too large or that grew too large from humbler beginnings be cast out, whatever the independence of the owners or the ingredients and equipment used. And of course, many suggested that a combination of these three parameters comprised the perfect definition of craft spirits. It seemed a rabbit hole of nasty nitpicking with no resolution in sight and no trade group or regulatory body yet authoritative enough to settle matters. The federal government did not define craft spirits and craft distilleries only by output and did not care to either. The same went for the states, though some states did account for size among other standards when attempting to define a craft distillery. The definitions thrown up by nascent trade groups such as Bill Owen's American Distilling Institute, which dated only from 2002, were largely ignored, or just more grist for the rancor mill. Even a gamely thorough attempt from a spin-off of Owen's group, in the form of a 59-page analysis released in late 2016, failed to settle the matter, though it came closer than anyone or anything before. "There is no universally accepted definition of craft spirits in the industry," the report read, "and the expression craft spirit is not protected in any way." That was and is true. Yet, one feature kept coming up again and again as I waded into the definition debate. Volume, or the amount of output. No one and no group, including critics, the federal government, and people within the industry, seemed to dispute that you had to at least make a spirit in small batches to call it craft. A distillery might grow larger over time, producing oceans of a once small batch offering, but it had to at least start small. Even the largest distilling concerns, conglomerates with myriad holdings at all sorts of price points, made small batch offerings that looked and tasted different than those made in vastly larger quantities. And even those faux craft distilleries released their offerings in small amounts, and consequently ordered relatively small amounts from larger producers. Volume and output mattered, no one disagreed. One could be big, but one had to work small. One could be faux, but not go long. Smallness was the defining characteristic of craft spirits, the ethos that cut through everything. The term craft spirits clouded that characteristic, however, much in the same way that the attempts to fit craft spirits into craft beer's taste template and timeline did. Craft spirits and craft beer were complementary, but they were different. The same held for craft spirits and fine wine. The rise of all three beverages after World War II spectacularly altered the American palatal landscape, helping each other find new fans and a prominent place in the nation's commerce and very psyche. America is the biggest wine marketplace on earth. having wrested that title in 2014 from centuries-long hegemon France. It is also the leader in beer style, the nation that one-time leaders such as Germany and Belgium now look toward for inspiration. American craft spirits has no such international prominence, at least not yet. Certain brands and distilling trends are popular overseas, make no mistake, but the industry is light years from enjoying the sort of influence that American winemakers and brewers do. Part of that is age. American fine wine goes back to just after Prohibition in the 1930s and really picked up steam in the 1960s. American craft beer also gained momentum in the 1960s and was stepping onto the world stage by the end of the 1980s. It was not until the 2000s that Americans began talking and writing widely in terms of craft spirits, however. Much of that writing has focused on trying to define what constituted a craft spirit, and by extension, a craft distillery or distiller. I would argue that the focus should not be on trying to make craft spirits stick. It is a term born of the misguided attempt to define the movement in terms of craft beer. Instead, the focus should be on small batch, both as an adjective and a noun. Craft spirits made or released in small batches can come from any size distillery. Yet, these small batches invariably share common characteristics: more traditional ingredients, the precise attentions of an often very skilled distiller, higher price tags, and most importantly, that more pronounced, multi-layered taste I first discovered at Grand Ten in South Boston. Craft spirits, then, should be retired as quickly as possible, perhaps to the same beachfront condo as table wine, a once widely used term to describe less expensive, drier wines made from European grape varietals such as Merlot and Chardonnay. I argued in my last book that fine wine would suffice for all of it, at whatever price point. To declare otherwise was to ignore the long, slogging history behind the rise of such wines in the United States. They were all part of the same eventual triumph. Indeed, the variations in price were a sign of that success. Yet, fine wine had long existed as a term to describe at least the pricier plunk. Small batch spirits has not been as widely used as craft spirits, but I will use it nonetheless, because it describes so much better what distillers are trying to achieve and have achieved. That is because the success of the movement it is supposed to describe renders craft spirits largely useless, if not soon obsolete. Curiously, as I type this in the spring of 2016, the same thing is already happening to craft beer, with brewers, critics, and consumers increasingly calling for the term to be scotched in favor of simply beer. The June 2015 cover of All About Beer, the industry's leading trade magazine, declared, "Craft beer is dead. Long live craft beer." The characteristics and the things to love remain. The term, like with craft spirits, just doesn't work anymore. Small batch is not perfect, but it certainly works better. Should these small batch distillers and their customers ever settle the definition of the movement, there will be nothing stopping it. Even with the controversy, it is gaining in numbers, in fans, and in institutional heft, the kind of heft able to bend government to its priorities, particularly on taxes, a potential game changer that this book will explore in depth, along with other possible shifts poised to help craft spirits thrive. The American craft spirits movement, as the 21st century chugs along, has become one of the most impactful and interesting culinary trends in the nation since World War II. And it's so young, its rise only really kicking into gear in the past 10 to 15 years. This book is the story of that rise and the conditions that made it possible. The story intersects often with those other two great libationary success stories, fine wine and craft beer. It also runs alongside and then overtakes contemporary trends such as the foodie culture, which has helped change the way Americans eat, and the newfound popularity of cocktails, some made from nearly extinct concoctions that the American craft spirits movement helped resuscitate. Developments in other countries, most profoundly the proliferation of single malt whiskies in Scotland, as well as lesser-known trends such as the resurrection of micro-distillation of tequila in Mexico, also affected the growth of craft spirits here in ways that cannot be overstated. Also, by necessity, especially in a nation that has long had a rocky relationship with spirits and drinking in general, the book will focus on controversies that almost croaked the whole enterprise. Finally, by necessity as well, I will delve deep into the development of certain macro spirits, those made in such large quantities from the get-go that they could never be considered small batch. These spirits, developed and marketed as they were and as successful as they became, set the table for their tinier counterparts later on. Their challenges and triumphs are almost just as important, if not more so, and deserve significant attention. As one noted critic told me early on in my research, Absolut, that mass-produced, exceedingly gimmicky Swedish vodka, popularized the notion of a higher-end spirit in the American marketplace, the sort of super-premium libation consumers asked for by name, price tag be damned. Craft spirits would later feast on that notion. Finally, what this book is not is a tasting guide, nor is it a guide to buying spirits or making them. That's illegal without the proper licensing, more on that later. There are plenty of fine examples of those in print and online, including ones that explain such features of distillation as still types and aging processes. I was pleasantly relieved to find that a phalanx of critics had been writing authoritatively for years about the subject of small-batch spirits. I drank deeply from the wells of their analyses and leaned on their research where primary sources could not be found. And while distilling can be highly technical, I will try to avoid over-explaining those technicalities, which can quickly become a major lesson involving nearly every major scientific field, from botany to physics, with history and anthropology added on. Basically, distillation involves a three-step process: the fermentation of fruit or grains, then the heating of that fermented batch to purify and strengthen it, and then, often, a blending with other spirits or with water to achieve a certain taste and alcoholic strength. Distillers use either a squatter vessel called a pot still or a taller one called a column still for the distillation, or a combination of the two. And a column still is essentially several stacked pot stills. The differences between both will be explained when necessary, as will the differences in various spirits ingredients, some of which involve additions such as herbs and spices. Enough with the mechanics. The first of its kind, this book is meant to be a romping tale through the maturation of the American palate when it came to whiskey, vodka, brandy, gin, rum, and other spirits. It jumps around geographically quite a bit. America is a big country, and its distillers diffuse, woven into its very fabric from the Republic's earliest days. But one theme runs through: the hard-won triumph of small-batch distilling. As the forthcoming tale will tell, victory was far from assured. It seemed to take forever. And just as the movement of greatest glory arrived, the American small-batch spirits movement appeared to sow the seeds of its own destruction. The story, however, begins decades before all this, and fittingly enough, with one man seeking to make a better spirit, one small batch at a time. Part 1. That shit will blow your ears off. 1953 to 1959, Loretto, Kentucky. Bill Samuels grew up around bourbon, though he did not particularly like the dark brown, corn-based spirit that had been distilled in Kentucky since before American independence. The Samuels family had been making bourbon commercially since at least the mid-1800s. Perhaps even further back to when much of Kentucky was the far western frontier of the Commonwealth of Virginia. Samuel's great-grandfather, T.W. Samuels, started an eponymous distillery in Deetsville, 40 miles south of Louisville, in 1844. The ownership structure changed in the 20th century, including before and after Prohibition, in the 1920s and early 1930s, although it always involved the Samuels clan, which lived on Whiskey Road in nearby Bardstown. Neighbors included James Beauregard Beam, whose nickname and surname would grace perhaps the world's most famous bourbon label. The brown-haired, slimly built Bill Samuels, then just 26, took over management of the distillery in 1936 after his father died. Amid this change, one thing held constant: the iffy quality, and therefore taste, of T.W. Samuels whiskey, which, through its corn-heavy recipe, was technically from the bourbon branch of the stylistic spirit tree. "That shit will blow your ears off." That was the assessment of Marge Samuels, Bill's wife, of bourbon in general in the 1950s. Distilled primarily from corn, bourbon distillers also typically added rye, a coarse grain that gave it a rougher mouthfeel, and barley, used primarily to spur fermentation. Its enzymes broke down the grain starches into sugars, which yeast could then convert into ethanol. The smell and taste of that alcohol was also front and center for most bourbon, condemning it to be the sort of firewater one knocked back quickly, and with a chaser of beer, water, or something else coldly soothing, rather than sip genteelly for the texture and aroma. Bill Samuels himself had a physical aversion to spiciness. He never ate Mexican food, for one thing, and he found drinking bourbon, even his family's, a chore rather than a delight, something akin to a waking nightmare for a resident of Kentucky, which produced nearly all of the world's bourbon, and which very likely gave the spirit its name through its Bourbon County, which was once much bigger than its present-day borders. The state's signature beverage was often described as a back-of-the-mouth drink best swallowed fast for a rollicking buzz, not a front-of-the-mouth one for a tippler to roll around the tongue and savor. One reason for this perception was the rye-reliant tradition. Another was the larger bourbon industry itself, abetted by the federal government. American bourbon makers staggering out of prohibition in 1933 faced stiff competition from foreign imports, particularly whiskies from Ireland, Scotland, and Canada. The former two had never dealt with a widespread alcohol ban, and Canada's experiment with prohibition ended long before that of the United States. To hurry up and compete, bourbon makers released wares that had not been sufficiently aged. Bourbon usually spent at least a few years in new oak barrels, which had been charred on the inside first, before bottling. The resultant releases tasted terrible to seasoned bourbon drinkers, and they saddled the brownest of the brown whiskeys in America with a reputation as swill, according to one observer. Nothing in the rules, though, prevented distilleries from spilling this swill onto the market. Federal benchmarks dictated that a whiskey could call itself bourbon if at least 51% of its grain bill was corn, it was aged in previously unused oak barrels that had been charred on the inside, and it entered the aging barrel at a certain alcohol strength, or proof, and was bottled at a certain proof as well. These were not exactly exacting regulations, and some distillers took advantage to produce oceans of so-so product as more and more lighter whiskies and blends flooded the market. World War II placed the industry at a further disadvantage. The Federal War Production Board took over the distilling industry nationwide and swung it from making ethyl alcohol-based beverages, such as bourbon, to industrial alcohol. Materials such as grains and glass became scarcer, too, as the fight against fascism in Germany, Japan, and Italy gobbled up more and more resources. This caused much of the U.S. bourbon industry to stand largely still in the 1940s, when it could have been using the time to ramp up its presence versus the foreign interlopers. Some people in the bourbon industry decided to get out of the game altogether. At the start of the 1940s, Robert Block, a Cincinnati businessman who partnered with the Samuels family during those anxious days after Prohibition, sold control of T.W. Samuels Distillery in Loretto to a New York company that then changed the distillery's name to Country Distilleries. Bill Samuels initially fought the sale and then, realizing there was nothing he could do, sold his shares and left the now former family firm shortly afterward to launch his own distillery. He did not need the money, The sale of the shares ensured a comfortable life, as did some property he already owned. By all accounts, though, Bill Samuels Sr. was a restless sort, especially when it came to bourbon and his family's history with it. He could not just sit around the house in Bardstown. He had to do something. The Samuels name in spirits could not be allowed to end with a partner sale to a third party out of New York City. Legal wrangling over the new distillery's use of the Samuels name held up Bill Samuels' launch for a decade. An appellate court eventually affirmed a lower bench's ruling that some aspects of the Samuels name could appear on the new distillery's packaging, but it could not use T.W. Samuels as a brand name. That restriction would become a moot point shortly after 1953, the year Samuels purchased a 200-acre farm in Loretto. The farm had been the site of an old distillery, built over 10 buildings in the 1880s, that Prohibition, 40 years later, wiped out. Samuels renamed his larger property Star Hill Farm and began restoring the distillery buildings with the aim of producing bourbon. Not just any bourbon, however. To smooth the drink's rough edges, and for his own palatal edification, he developed a recipe that did not include rye, and that instead leaned on winter wheat as the secondary ingredient after the style-defining corn, with barley making up the rest of the grain bill. It was not a particularly original pivot. The distillery at Star Hill Farm had made an industrial alcohol using wheat. As for spirits, George Washington's distillery at his Mount Vernon, Virginia estate had experimented with wheat a century and a half before, as had other distilleries more recently, including Stitzel Weller in Shively, Kentucky, just southwest of Louisville. Traveling salesman Julian Pappy Van Winkle and a friend started Stitzel Weller in 1935 after buying up a wholesaler and a distillery and then combining the two. Its brands, including Old Fitzgerald and Rebel Yell, used wheat. Samuels was friends with Van Winkle, and he was among those consulted as Samuels built the recipe for his new bourbon around wheat. The secondary ingredient, then, was not new, but the way Samuels intended to wield its effects was positively revolutionary for the early 1950s. Here would be a wheated bourbon deliberately crafted in small batches for drinkers to savor. Perhaps it would change the public's entire perception of bourbon. Such an approach, with wheat at its back, flew in the face of both history and the marketplace. The genesis of bourbon stretched back to at least the Seven Years' War, a conflict between the United Kingdom and France over territories in the New World. The United Kingdom won in the early 1760s and took as part of its booty the area containing the future Commonwealth of Kentucky. Scotch and Scotch-Irish settlers pushed into the new British holding, taking with them their thirst for whiskey. That whiskey had relied upon grains such as barley and rye for its production, grains that were harder to come by in the new land, which the Appalachian Mountains cut off from suppliers on the East Coast, and the terrain of which was not as fertile a ground for the sprouts. So, the settlers instead grew corn, a crop that Native Americans had long cultivated in the area's rockier, sandier soil. Corn then became the ballast for the settlers' whiskey. They also borrowed from French cognac makers and Caribbean rum distillers the idea of barrel aging, in this case in charred oak, so as to smooth out this harsher whiskey as much as possible, and, as it happened, to turn its color brown. The uniformity of aging for any greater length of time came later. The work involved in producing bourbon was too much for settlers living hand to mouth to have it end in waiting years for a sip. But by the dawn of the 19th century, the outline of bourbon as a distinct American spirit was clear. Corn, charred barrels, some aging. So much so that the federal government in the following century would use that outline as the parameters for recognizing bourbon as unlike other types of alcoholic beverages, whether foreign or domestic. As for the contour of that bourbon county, it too became much clearer. The domain simply known as Bourbon, after the surname of the French royal family, had once encompassed some 34 of present-day Kentucky's counties. It shrank to its current borders just northeast of Lexington in 1785, 7 years before Kentucky broke off from Virginia as America's 15th state. By that time, this newfangled whiskey style that the county had likely given its name to was spreading throughout the emerging nation via the Kentucky-bordering Mississippi and Ohio rivers. Many of the industry's first families, too, including the Samuelses and their neighbors, the Beams, were firmly established in the trade around this time. Bourbon and tobacco became the principal exports from Kentucky's interior just after the start of the 19th century. Customs officials in Louisville recorded 2.25 million gallons of bourbon passing through just the Ohio River in 1822, a volume nearly tenfold greater than just 12 years before. Technological improvements in the coming decades, especially the railroads, which shipped vast amounts of corn from newly settled territories such as Nebraska and Iowa, only boosted bourbon's popularity and production numbers. Corn cultivation in the United States leaped from 838 million bushels just before the Civil War to 2.7 billion at the dawn of the 20th century, 40 years later. As for that Civil War in the 1860s, it rent Kentucky, a slave state that stayed in the Union, with guerrilla warfare, invasions, and counter-invasions scarring its landscape. "I hope to have God on my side," President Abraham Lincoln, a native Kentuckian, was reputed to have said at the start of the war, "but I must have Kentucky." Still, the bourbon flowed. So popular was it that unscrupulous distillers took advantage of its reputation and of the technological advances to churn out counterfeit bourbons, usually cheaply made, little-aged whiskey with no more than brown food coloring added. The federal government intervened forcefully, beginning with landmark legislation in 1897 that stipulated the origins and aging times of whiskey in general. The so-called Bottled in Bond Act also stipulated when taxes could be collected, generally after the whiskey comes out of the barrel after years of aging, allowing distillers to better plan their payments. Previously, the federal government could collect at will. The new rules, though, did little to curb the production of inferior bourbons, especially ones that had not been aged sufficiently. Distillers with an eye more on the margins than the mouthfeel continued to churn out the ear-burning fire water that Marge Samuels so disdained. Still, as Bill Samuels prepared to launch his own distillery on Star Hill Farm, it looked like Americans could not get enough of that corn-infused fire water. From 1951 to 1962, production of Scotch and Canadian whiskey, two of the lighter whiskeys that made their runs at bourbon following Prohibition and through World War II, increased by 12.4 million and 5.3 million gallons, respectively. Bourbon production, however, catapulted to 37.5 million gallons during the same period. In 1950, bourbon accounted for nearly a quarter of the bottled whiskey in the United States. In 1961, it would claim just under half. One reason for this was a genuine thirst for the spirit, one born of decades of familiarity. Another reason was a concerted marketing effort on the part of distillers, and in some cases, their corporate parents. Paid advertising in newspapers and magazines painting bourbon as a natural accoutrement to any civilized evening increased several times over during the 1950s. In the case of magazines, a stunning 30-fold. That shit might blow your ears off, but more and more living rooms featured a cabinet stocked with not just one, but a few brands of bourbon. Bourbon had entered a statistical golden age of robust demand, with sales on their way to increasing 200% for the 20 years after World War II, and exports running to more than 100 nations. The Kentucky-centric bourbon industry had survived Prohibition, the war, intense foreign competition, and its own questionable and indifferent quality. And it was thriving. Why mess with a steady success born of centuries of experience? What was T.W. Samuel's great-grandson thinking? It was not only that his bourbon recipe would substitute milder wheat for chalkier rye, it was also that Bill Samuels planned to produce his whiskey in smaller batches and charge more for it. The trend, as the industry boomed, had been toward larger and more modern distilleries, complete with vast warehouse floors studded with stainless steel vats, tuns for mashing, and tall column stills for large-scale distilling. Samuel's operation would be out of the tinier 19th-century distillery in tiny Loretto, with its population of a few hundred souls. And it would lean heavily at first on squatter, more traditional pot stills instead of the long-necked column ones, which, while more efficient, generally did not impart as much complexity and texture to darker spirits such as bourbon, though bourbon makers often employed both. The pot stills were used in a second distillation for those complexities and textures. As for the price, Samuel's bourbon would retail for as much as $3 more per bottle than the wares of competitors such as Jim Beam. Not that too many people regarded Samuel's startup as serious competition. Even relatives saw it as more a hobby than anything. The trend was toward bigger, not smaller, and not just through greater production and grander production facilities. Jim Beam, for instance, conveniently made its bourbon available to bars near the rapidly multiplying number of U.S. military bases worldwide. Besides, rye had worked just fine as the secondary grain in bourbon for as long as anyone could remember. Never mind that Samuel's distillery was not simply out of context for bourbon in the 1950s, it was out of context for American food and drink in general. Americans, a post-war economic boom at their backs, wanted speed and sameness. Swanson introduced the first TV dinners in 1954. They could be zapped to edibility in minutes in microwaves, a newer invention that was on its way to outselling gas-range stovetops. The first McDonald's franchises opened in the early 1950s, and supermarkets arose around the same period. One-stop food shopping for the first time in the histories of many cities and towns. Nothing illustrated the national craving for sameness and speed in food better than what was happening in drink, specifically in beer and wine. The number of breweries had shrunk precipitously following World War II, as big producers such as Miller and Anheuser-Busch used their superior capital to scale up. Soon, five breweries would produce more than half of the nation's beers, and almost everything produced was a bland, watery spin on the classic Czech lager type called Pilsner. It was easier to make than more nuanced lager and ale styles, and could ship well far and wide on the nation's new interstate highway system, which also grew up in the 1950s. As for wine, a similar consolidation was in order. The E&J Gallo Winery out of Modesto, California, was on its way to claiming an incredible one-third of the bottles sold in the United States. And most of those bottles, from Gallo and other competitors, were of sweeter, fortified wines made from nondescript utilitarian grapes, such as Carignan and Alicante Boucher. Only a handful of wineries worked with the likes of Cabernet Sauvignon and Chardonnay, and their distribution was infinitesimal in comparison, as was the cultivation of grapes they used. Take Merlot grapes. By 1960, the variety covered only 50 acres of California, while Alicante Boucher, a thick-skinned, pulpy workhorse comfortable with quick fermentations, covered 25,000. These decade-long trends seemed unlikely to reverse themselves. Analysts, for one thing, were predicting a single American brewery by the start of the 21st century. As for spirits, a consolidation wave loomed for that industry too, as one-time smaller family-owned operations took on partners to stay financially alive and then grew rapidly, bourbon distilleries especially. The idea of small-batch production in a smaller, refurbished rather than brand-new distillery with a major recipe shift to boot, seemed unnecessarily archaic, a recipe in itself for financial struggle and likely failure. Samuels did it anyway. In decades-long hindsight, it proved a crucial part of a seismic shift for American food and drink. Nearly a half century after Samuel started distilling in Loretto, a private trade group called the American Distilling Institute attempted the first widely cited definition of what constituted a craft spirit in the United States. The initial part of the American Distilling Institute's definition concerned ownership. Craft spirits are the products of an independently owned distillery. Samuel's operation was certainly independently owned as well as operated. The second part of the definition described reach. An American craft distillery should have maximum annual sales of 52,000 cases of 12 750 milliliter bottles. Samuel's output that first year, and for several years after, would number in the hundreds of cases. Finally, the Institute declared that to call itself craft, a distillery's product should be physically distilled and bottled on site. That is exactly what Samuels did in tiny Loretto. Many would ignore, if not deride, the American Distilling Institute's 21st century attempt at defining a craft spirit. No one could or would ignore the contribution Bill Samuels Sr. made. It would take years to recognize it, but his humble toils in a remote area of the American Empire, largely notable solely because of bourbon and almost entirely beyond the ken of the coastal elites who dictated America's politics, fashions, and tastes, flew laughably in the face of where the nation's spirits in general were going as the latter half of the 20th century got underway. Small batch production was out, large scale was ascendant. This had not been the case two generations earlier. By 1900, there were perhaps 8,000 distilleries in the United States of various sizes making myriad spirits, from whiskeys such as bourbon to vodkas to rums to brandies, ballasted by a rainbow of fruits. The industry had deep roots. George Washington's Mount Vernon estate in Northern Virginia had been the nation's largest whiskey distillery at the start of the 19th century, and spirits, particularly rum and whiskey, including bourbon, were the nation's best-selling alcoholic beverage until the decades after the Civil War, when increasingly well-automated breweries stormed the marketplace with that homogeneous bastardization of Pilsner, and California wineries figured out how to ship farther in bulk more cheaply. The number of distilleries held impressively, however. There may have been around 2,000 in 1910, buoyed by vast numbers of bars, especially in larger cities, and the cocktail culture they spawned. Politicians, too, going back to at least the presidential race of 1828, when Andrew Jackson routinely lavished free spirits on rallies of supporters, ensured a steady demand. In Appalachia, including parts of Kentucky, and other more remote areas of the nation's vast interior, home distilling, often dubbed moonshining, continued into the 20th century, as it had for at least two centuries before, with hand-jiggered equipment and the basest of ingredients. This steady demand, however, walked hand in hand for decades with a passionate set of critics spurred by religious fervor and genuine concern over the deleterious effects of too much drink. These anti-alcohol activists had always been able to claim small victories. Most newspapers, and certainly most mass-circulated family-friendly magazines, did not accept advertisements for spirits. Popular movies and books, huge forms of entertainment in the pre-television age, often depicted strong drink as the gateway to all sorts of irreversibly hellish behavior. The opposition eventually shifted from the public arena to the political one, and the victories became much more thumping. Beginning with Maine in 1846, several states, as well as local governments such as counties, passed laws banning the sale of alcohol, except in certain circumstances, such as for medicinal use. The pace picked up in the early 20th century as the pace of Americans' drinking picked up. Six states from 1907 through 1909 went dry, bringing the total to 11. Around the same time, per-person consumption of alcohol, spirits or otherwise, jumped nearly one-third. The echoing brewing boom drove much of this increase. The number of breweries nationwide had peaked at around 4,000 in the 1870s and was still counted in the thousands by the second decade of the 20th century. Moreover, a spike in immigration from southern Europe, particularly from southern Italy, wove wine consumption into the wider daily fabric of American life. These foreign Arabists and their bibulous ways panicked the mostly native-born anti-alcohol activists already concerned that the increase in dry territory had had little effect on drinking totals. They then made a historic legislative and media push throughout the 1910s, scoring their ultimate victory, Prohibition, and its enforcing Volstead Act in 1919. Alcohol was out. Its manufacture, transportation, distribution, and sale, with a handful of strictly enforced exceptions, was illegal throughout America, a nation that George Washington, its founding father, had once plied with whiskey. The number of distilleries in the United States dropped 85% during the 13 years of Prohibition. The ones that survived produced alcohol mostly for industrial use. Nearly all spirits wholesalers, those individuals and firms that distributed the distillery's products, went out of business. Not surprisingly, and despite a now legendary trade in illegally made spirits, alcohol consumption plunged throughout the 1920s and into the 1930s to an average of 1.5 gallons per person per year, well below the pre-Prohibition average of more than 2.5 gallons. Also largely wiped out, or at least forced underground, was the cocktail culture centered on spirits. Certainly gone for good was the use of whiskey, rum, and others to oil political rallies. Most pernicious for American spirits was not what Prohibition destroyed, but instead what it strengthened. The zealous aversion to alcohol that fueled the push for Prohibition before 1919, and that sustained it through the crime and resistance it spawned in the 1920s, carried on long after its end at the national level in 1933. Alcohol, spirits especially, became exotic to an entire generation of Americans, a feeling that that generation passed down to its progeny and that government at all levels sustained through onerous regulations for opening bars, starting breweries, getting distilling licenses, etc. Wine would eventually cloak itself in an aura of exclusivity and refinement to fully recover. Beer would succeed through sheer volume and massive marketing budgets, not to mention its lower alcohol content. Spirits, on the other hand, carried around the psychological effects of Prohibition like Marley's chains. It became something one should avoid, something associated with overindulgence, with failure even. What one analyst said about wine coming out of Prohibition could be said much more loudly about spirits. A feature of American life going back to before the Revolution, it was now something in the bastard category of things legally allowed but morally reprehensible. By 1954, Bill Samuel's new wheat-heavy bourbon was maturing in barrels in Loretto, with a release plan toward the end of the decade. In the meantime, Marge Samuels devised bottle designs and a name for the new distillery and its flagship spirit. She collected pewter, as well as bottles of the framed French brandy called cognac, and made a point of searching for the physical mark that the individuals behind the finished product often left on the bottle. Moreover, cognac bottles were sometimes sealed with wax to prevent oxygen from seeping in and ruining the brandy. Marge Samuels devised the name Maker's Mark for the bourbon, the name worked for the distillery too, and created some prototype bottles, complete with hand-torn beige labels featuring the Star Hill Farm name prominently and its Loretto location. Marge also dipped the bottle tops in hot red wax, which made each one different from the others, depending on how the wax hardened. It was a labor-intensive move that made Bill nervous, but it stuck, as it were, and the red dip tip became an international emblem of Maker's Mark. Or at least, it did eventually. In May 1958, Samuels bottled one barrel of Maker's Mark and sent much of it, perhaps 15 bottles, to a convention of wine and spirits wholesalers in Chicago in the hopes of landing distributors. He sent some of the remaining few bottles to the Keeneland Racetrack in Lexington for its fall races, and he kept the rest to serve to various civic and business groups with which he was associated as a way to build some buzz for the new brand. The buzz had already started years before. Kentucky's bourbon industry was a clubby affair, and Samuels had called on the expertise of members of some of the other first families, including neighbors in Bardstown such as Jerry Beam, Jim's son, and Ed Shapira, whose family rescued and resurrected the old Heaven Hill Springs distillery. He also used his own expertise to divine the best materials for his recipe, including the barrels. For those, Samuels connected with the Independent Stave Company, a Missouri manufacturer that left its oak barrels outside for several months to dry, rather than use a faster-acting kiln. The outdoor time reduced the level of the wood's tannins, organic substances that could make spirits astringent and bitter. It was in these barrels that the first bourbons of Maker's Mark rested for one more summer after that unofficial rollout in 1958. Samuels felt they needed 6 full seasons to mature. In the fall of 1959, Maker's Mark debuted in restaurants and liquor stores throughout Kentucky, as well as over the Ohio River in southern Indiana and down into parts of Tennessee, which was the nation's second biggest bourbon-producing state. That was as far as the distillery's reach would extend that first decade. When Bill's son, Bill Jr., entered Vanderbilt Law School in 1964 in Nashville, he realized that he had perhaps the biggest supply of Maker's Mark in Tennessee. The novelty of the packaging, red tip and all, the relative tinniness of the distillery itself, the small batch production of what came out of the specially dried barrels as a smoother bourbon with sweet hints of vanilla on the finish, none of it seemed to stick beyond a coterie of aficionados who recognized the quality when they tasted it, but who could only buy so much. There would be advertising, including in August publications such as The New Yorker, under the tagline, "It tastes expensive and is." But that emphasis on costliness did not help matters, and Bill Samuels' attempt at a better bourbon faded from business plan to hobby as the 1950s bled into the 1960s. He could have pivoted back to rye as the main secondary ingredient and to a shorter aging time to get more product to market faster. Instead, Samuels resolutely stuck to wheat, to the 6-year maturations, and to the small-batch approach in the small-sized distillery in Loretto. No one knew it then, but bourbon's day was almost over anyway. The distinctly American spirit style was headed for a sales cliff dive, largely of its own making, because of the cheaper, rougher-tasting fire water so many distilleries made. For Samuels and his family, there was no going back. Not that they had to. The fortunes of the clan were not necessarily tied to their new bourbon. They had plenty to live on. It was more than money that kept Bill Samuels stubbornly on the small and narrow. Bill Samuels Jr., then 13, would recount decades later the chilly February day in 1954 that his father kept him and his sisters home from school to attend a little ceremony at Star Hill Farm for the first barreling of Maker's Mark. Bill Sr. told the assembled, which included old friends and new competitors from the industry, that his family was leaving tradition behind to invent a bourbon that actually tasted good. It was a deliberately momentous occasion, though no one would realize just how momentous until decades later. He then stuffed a decades-old family recipe for T.W. Samuels into a jug, stuck some other papers in after it, and spread lighter fluid around inside. Finally, he lit up a match and dropped it in. Just as he did so, One of his daughters put her face over the tapered opening. The resulting burst of flame singed her hair. It was the last time the family hosted a ceremony like that. Changes Brewing, 1965 to 1975, San Francisco, Napa Valley.
"Have you ever been to the brewery?"
Fred Q asked his regular, a 25-year-old ex-graduate student in Japanese studies from the Midwest by way of Stanford. The young man always ordered the same beer at Q's old spaghetti factory bar in San Francisco's trendy North Beach neighborhood, an Anchor Steam.
"No," the young man answered. "You ought to see it. It's closing in a day or two, and you ought to see it. You'd like it."
The next morning, Q's regular took his suggestion and walked the mile and a half from his apartment to the brewery at 8th and Brannan Streets. After about an hour of poking around, he bought a 51% stake for less than the price of a used car. Fritz Maytag now controlled what turned out to be the last independently owned brewery in America making beer in small batches from traditional ingredients, the hallmarks of what came to be called craft brewing. He could do it. Maytag's great-grandfather and namesake, Frederick Louis Maytag, the eldest of 10 children born to German immigrants in central Iowa, had founded the Maytag Washing Machine Company some 6 decades before. The family firm grew literally into a household name, its machines spreading rapidly, especially with the nation's post-World War II economic boom, which included the development of vast prairies of suburban housing. The revenue allowed Frederick Louis's descendants to expand into other business interests. Frederick Louis II, his grandson and Fritz Maytag's father, used some help from the dairy science department at Iowa State and a herd of Holstein cows his father had acquired for their farm, about 35 miles east of Des Moines, to create a blue cheese in the Roquefort style of France. Like the French, Frederick Louis II aged this Maytag blue cheese in caves, 2 110-foot-deep ones dug into the Newton farm in 1941. For Fritz Maytag, the cheese business, which he inherited in 1962 when Frederick Louis II died, was quite a game-changer, something that stuck with him through the years in the Bay Area and right into his ownership of Anchor.
"I saw the pride with which my father reacted when people would ask him, 'Have you anything to do with that blue cheese?' I saw that, and I saw that I had a chance of developing a food product that could do the same."
The idea was preposterous in 1965. American beer was trending in the exact opposite direction, away from distinctly made brands and styles to one watery adaptation of the Czech-style Pilsner made by fewer and fewer well-capitalized operations. Maytag was very aware of the challenge ahead of him. The brewery he bought had been through several owners since its establishment in 1896, during a kind of post-Civil War heyday for American brewing, when the number of breweries swelled to around 4,000 and the idea of locally made beer for a local and appreciative audience did not seem so absurd. Anchor had flirted with ruin and disaster a few times in the 69 years before Maytag rescued it. A fire that the great earthquake of 1906 spawned destroyed one location, and a fall from one of San Francisco's newly introduced cable cars killed an owner the following year. This difficult history and a dwindling consumer base amid the larger industry's consolidation left a crude and primitive brewery for Maytag to find. There weren't any of the flashes of the bigger operations like Anheuser-Busch or Miller, no stainless steel piping or fermentation vats, not even refrigeration for storing bottled or kegged beers. Instead, Anchor's tiny space in the rumbling shadow of an Interstate 80 overpass contained one pump, some copper kettles straight out of the 19th century, and one understandably jaded employee. The brewery also lacked a serious number of sales accounts. Were it not for eccentric devotees of locally made beer, including Q at the old spaghetti factory, who took about 10 of the approximately 100 kegs Anchor produced monthly,
Maytag was convinced the brewery would go out of business. He threw himself into salesmanship, distribution, and quality control those first years, schlepping the hilly streets of San Francisco, talking about this so-called steam beer, a caramelly lager made in small quantities with traditional ingredients such as malted barley, hops, and yeast, no adjuncts such as corn to speed fermentation or assorted chemicals to help with head retention or preservation. Just beer as it had been made in the past, before Prohibition set the clock so far back. Try it? The pitch started to work. The brewery gained more accounts through the late 1960s, and the signature steam beer got better and better. Simple tweaks such as a cleaner brewhouse worked wonders for what had been before Maytag a rather iffy beer quality-wise. In April 1971, Anchor also became the first craft brewery since Prohibition to start bottling its beer. A short time later, Maytag was able to hire a distributor, freeing up more of his time for quality control and salesmanship. Finally, the brewery started rattling off an impressive run of stylistic firsts. First new porter since Prohibition, resurrecting the dark, malty style that initially arose in England in the 1800s. First American-made seasonal beer since Prohibition, a spicily sweet Christmas ale, and what came to be recognized as the first American-inflected India Pale Ale, the citrusy, bitter Anchor Liberty Ale in 1975. Few people noticed, especially not beyond Anchor's growing but still small universe of clients and champions. The vast majority of American beer drinkers wanted their homogenized, watered-down Pilsner, ice cold and in copious quantities, the additives and artificiality be damned. The 1975 debut of Miller Lite, the first widely available light beer in the United States, would only underline this reality. Thin, watery, nearly translucent, and barely bitter, Anchor Liberty Ale was four times as bitter, Miller Lite proved a commercial smash, propelling its maker from the back of the pack of America's top 10 breweries to number 2 behind Anheuser-Busch. That brewery felt compelled to introduce its own light beer offering in 1977, Busch Light, and again in 1982, Bud Light. Soon, light beer was the best-selling style in the United States and the most famous American-born style in the world. This was a sort of success that Fritz Maytag and his small crew simply could not fathom. Anchor Brewing would remain the only craft brewer in America through 1975, and largely a money loser to boot, its well-endowed and tenacious leader all that was standing between it and oblivion, or perhaps a second life as a brand in a much bigger brewery's portfolio. Despite the struggles, Maytag was determined to keep his brewery small. "I want to make all our beer in this building, hands-on," he would tell people. That one contemporary described the building as a dump was beside the point. Small batch, traditional, and independently owned, that was the way Maytag wanted things to stay at Anchor, even if it meant its demise. "I mean this," he also said. "We do not want, emphatically do not want, to get too big." Maytag's intellectual doppelganger in the wine world would have agreed with everything about his approach and thought process, up to that point about not wanting to get too big. Robert Mondavi wanted his new winery to get big because he thought big, on a grander scale, in fact, than many Americans had ever thought when it came to wine and its potential in the United States. In November 1965, only a few months after Maytag bought control of Anchor down in San Francisco, Mondavi had been unceremoniously booted from day-to-day employment with his family's winery in Napa Valley, called Charles Krug, after the mid-19th century Prussian who founded it. Though it would be decades, really, before hindsight provided the lens to view them properly, these twin events, Maytag's takeover and Mondavi's termination, marked the respective starts of the stylistic and cultural rebirths of wine and beer in the United States. Much as Bill Samuel Sr.'s launch of Maker's Mark a decade before did for the rebirth of spirits. Samuel's Loretto, Kentucky operation remained an anomaly in spirits, with Maytag and Mondavi more his intellectual cousins than any fellow distillers. The men did not know each other, but they were unwittingly working in concert toward the same seemingly unattainable goal, changing the way Americans drank. Robert Mondavi faced perhaps the easiest route of the three, though its navigation still looked far from assured. The Mondavi's Charles Krug stood at the intersection of American wine in the mid-20th century. On one side were the money-making generic wines made from lower-end, more utilitarian grape varieties that were easier and cheaper to grow. They also tended to be pulpier and therefore produced more juice, and could survive longer train and truck trips to farther-flung vendors. The generic wines these lower-end grapes produced tended to be sweet and strong, and Americans by and large lapped them up, usually from taps attached to bulk containers, hence the term bulk wines, a twin to generics, or more commonly, from glass-gallon jugs with screw tops. These generics did not simply outsell, but dwarfed drier, more nuanced fine wines, the other, tinier side of the industry at mid-century. By 1960, only a quarter of the wine consumed in the United States was fine wine from higher-end European-born grape varieties such as Cabernet Sauvignon, Merlot, or Chardonnay. These were generally simply unavailable outside of major metropolitan areas, which might each have a handful of retailers or restaurants that sold them. Most of the available U.S.-made wine instead flowed from lower-end workhorse grapes, such as Alicante Boucher and Carignan. If Americans ever did buy a bottle of fine wine, it was almost always from a French winery. France had led the world in fine wine production for as long as anyone alive could remember. Charles Krug was one of the few U.S. producers to craft at least some of its wines from these higher-end grape varieties so long associated with France. Critics particularly toasted its Cabernet Sauvignon, sourced from grapes cultivated in Napa Valley and fermented in open-top tanks made of redwood, a technique introduced in California in the previous century. The Mondavi family, led by parents Cesar and Rosa, purchased the winery in 1943 at the urging of their eldest son, Robert, who saw its potential to add luster to the clan's main business, sunny St. Helena. That generic wine producer churned out some 500,000 gallons annually of nondescript fare that was nonetheless popular with consumers and distributed beyond California, including to the East Coast. The distribution and the production placed sunny St. Helena comfortably toward the top of the approximately 40 wineries then operating in Napa Valley. Cesar and Rosa, a quiet force behind her husband's public face, saw no reason to tamper with a winning formula that the couple, originally from central Italy, had spent decades devising. Robert Mondavi was not satisfied. A gregarious, garrulous perfectionist with seemingly bottomless reserves of energy, he had long immersed himself in the tiny world of fine wine in America, which, largely because of Napa, centered on the San Francisco Bay Area. He dined at fine restaurants with decent wine lists. He hung out with the few other fine wine producers in the valley besides Charles Krug. He studied the latest techniques, including in a lab he built in an old water tower behind his St. Helena home. He even spent part of his 1940 honeymoon visiting some of sunny St. Helena's accounts. Robert Mondavi was very aware that several Americans had tried and failed to turn their countrymen on to fine wine styles such as Cabernet Sauvignon and Chardonnay, that most of the operations that had tried were small by any industry measure, production, distribution, clout in the grape-buying market. A winery owner focused on higher-end grapes might be his business's sole employee, or one of a handful, everyone pitching in on every aspect of the process. Robert, a well-traveled Stanford graduate, was also well aware of the seemingly endless second-class status of the rest of the winemaking world versus France, and he was convinced that he could change all that. His chance came in late 1965, after a violent falling out with his younger brother Peter, who ran the production side of Charles Krug. Simply put, the family and the winery had had it with Mondavi's hard-charging, blue-sky-thinking ways. Even his son Michael, about to graduate college, was frozen out. And Rosa Mondavi, Cesar had died in 1959, refused to intervene when her son pressed her. "If that's the case, Mother," Robert replied, "I'm going to build a winery." No one had started a significant new commercial winery in Napa Valley, America's premier winemaking region, since repeal in 1933. That was gutsy enough on Mondavi's part. What really made...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.